Thanks for joining us here on Indivisible. I'm your host, John Stubbins. We've got a special episode for you tonight here, live streaming. I want to first go to my documentary, American Anarchy. I want you to get behind this, folks. Look, we're going to be completing this documentary. The rest of this year, we're going to be filming. Then we have to get it to you, the American people. We can use all the help that we can get. Please go to my website. And you can go there at johnstubbins.com, johnstubbins.com, and you can donate there. You can also join us for our next Patriot Palooza that we're going to be having at Trump National on October the 5th. Again, that's October the 5th. It's in Virginia, just about 40 minutes outside of D.C. I hope that you will join us for the Patriot Palooza. It's going to be an amazing night. Again, if you go to johnstubbins.com, all the details that you will need are right there on the website. And I hope that you will join us for the event, October 5th. Again, we've got great speakers, great music. It's going to be an amazing night. Hope that you will join us. Now, on to why we're doing this show tonight, this special show. Every August, people come together to shine a light on Julian Assange. It is known as hashtag Assange-a-thon. And I want to read a quote here from Entheos. Quote, Julian Assange has been isolated and persecuted for more than a decade. This video is a collection of clips brought together from multiple perspectives over the past 12 years so that younger or older generations who have awakened recently, who may not know who Julian Assange is, this will tell you who he is and where his political persecution stands today. So, ladies and gentlemen, the key to preserving free speech for all of us is to not forget about those who have been locked away or persecuted for defending those rights we all cherish and that we need to maintain our freedom and not fall into 1,000 years of darkness. Again, unquote from Entheos. I present to you, folks, saving the life of Julian Assange. Please stand by for Julian Assange.
You guys, we do have the MyPillow 2.0 or 2.0, MyPillow 2.0, the best pillow in 20 years. We've improved on the best sleep ever, and use that promo code Invisible.
Indivisible.
Indivisible. Indivisible.
Yes, sir.
And if you use that, it's a buy one, get one free.
So few causes that seem to transcend political paradigms anymore. However, there is one that as we scan the independent media, freelance, journalist landscape that seems to bring credible people of all political persuasions into nearly 100% agreement. That subject is the unjust detention and political persecution of WikiLeaks founder Julian Assange. Today we come with a rare request for singleness of purpose on obtaining the freedom of Julian Assange, and for him to be reunited with his wife, children, mother, father, and family. On August 31st, in the year of our Lord, 2022, we're calling on people across the world to come together for one moment in time, on one thing everyone seems to agree upon, and change the course of history. We chose that day because this year will be the 25th anniversary. Princess Diana of Wales lost her life, and those who knew her say she had a beautiful heart and a merciful heart. So we have intentionally anchored that date of her passing to the day we'll call upon those in positions of influence and authority in the United States, Australia, and the United Kingdom to show mercy to Julian. We begin in the United Kingdom. We are calling for what's known as a royal prerogative of mercy for Julian Assange. A royal pardon, such as was received by World War II codebreaker Alan Turing a decade ago, but unfortunately many years after his death. And by setting the Diana date of August 31st, we are calling on younger members of the royal family and MPs to lead the way on this very noble cause. A chance to do something actually beneficial that will be memorialized for future generations. On August 31st, we're calling for what will be known as the Assange-a-thon. If you are an alternative media personality, public figure, artist, or any other walk of life, plan ahead and make those days from midnight to midnight focused on Julian. Run documentaries, conduct interviews, share Julian's story. We're also requesting that individuals from different political persuasions invite each other on their shows, not to argue about the hot topic of the day, but to unite for the freedom of Julian Assange. Make it so that anywhere people go, or whatever people are watching on that day, they'll be informed or reminded of his plight. We're giving everyone a few weeks to prepare. This is not just for those in media, this is for the people of the world. If you're a baker, feature cakes with Assange's photo. If you're an artist, use your talents to join in from now until then. If you're a musician, make a song. If you're a citizen of a country, just go out and wear pins or shirts or hats, start conversations. If you're on social media, change your avatar, put your banner up, and send copy Julian and his family and send messages of encouragement. Film yourself writing a letter to Julian while he's being held captive. Read the letter and upload it to TikTok as you send it. Imagine how inspirational that'd be for others, and for him to eventually hear and see. This two-part presentation is hastened a little bit because we fear for Julian's safety heading into the coming season. There are many extraordinary, both good and bad, events that are undoubtedly about to take place in the fall and beyond. As you look around, you can see that things haven't exactly been as stable as you may have remembered in the past. We must continue to right historical wrongs like this now, not later. During heavy news cycles, people often forget about unresolved ongoing persecution situations like Julian's, which can provide cover for score settling by the bad actors. Do you understand what we're telling you? We're tired of losing good men and women who simply want to bring consequential information and truths to the people. How many can you name that suddenly died over the past year, the past 2 years, the past 3 years? We're tired of losing people, and we're tired of people dying. We're tired of the persecution, and it has to stop. No more wet works. Over the past 15 years or so, independent media has been built up to a point that has never been seen before in history. But every now and then, we need a test to actually see what we are capable of if we come together as one. When you hear this, know that you are the rarest of rare souls that has that unique ability to knock down barriers between warring tribes. You listen to everyone. You show no contempt towards those you disagree with, and we could all learn a lot from you on that. You care about getting things right. You care about protecting innocent people. We need more Julian Assanges in this world.
My name is Julian Assange. We need your help. We need thousands of people, men and women, young and old, making a difference. Together, we can bring transparency, accountability, and justice.
If you're watching this video, and you're under the age of 25 years old, you may not know who Julian Assange is, and that what he could have possibly done to be isolated for so many years. Or perhaps you're 55, but you're just beginning to discover that you haven't been told the truth on an array of topics. So we've compiled key clips from multiple sources, from all different political viewpoints, so that you can fully grasp the gravity of his dire situation and how his case directly impacts the freedom and rights of you and your loved ones. And as for everybody else, have no worries, for we will not be playing any clips of this man, who is arguably the most difficult to listen to, download, in the history of broadcast television.
He was tough to look at.
He's the type that forces us to pay extra for ridiculous warning labels. And now for an important point that cannot be stressed enough. If you think all of this is about exposing alleged war crimes from the 2000s, you are mistaken. But we'll get to that in a moment. Many, mistakenly, casually pair Julian Assange with other known individuals who some claim are whistleblowers, just trying to do the right thing for the sake of transparency. But we're here to tell you, be very cautious in doing so. The face tells the story. Body language tells the story. Actions tell the story. There are mountains of difference between whistleblowing and undermining. Intention is everything. Motives are often masked by subterfuge. This is why some who launch political careers in the living rooms of nihilistic anti-American extremists who plotted for the elimination of 25 million people in the 1970s have no issue later pardoning or commuting sentences of someone who planned massive campaigns of bombing attacks and wanted to turn Puerto Rico into Castro-esque Cuba. But that's for another day.
I brought up the subject of what's going to happen after we take over the government. We become responsible then for administrating, 250 million people. And there was no answers. No one had given any thought to economics. How are you going to clothe and feed these people? The only thing that I could get was that they expected that the Cubans and the North Vietnamese and the Chinese and the Russians would all want to occupy different portions of the United States. They also believed that their immediate responsibility would be to protect against what they called the counter-revolution. And they felt that this counter-revolution could best be guarded against by creating and establishing re-education centers in the Southwest, where we would take all the people who needed to be re-educated into the new way of thinking and teach them how things were going to be. I ask, well, what is going to happen to those people that we can't re-educate, that are die-hard capitalists? And the reply was that they'd have to be eliminated. And when I pursued this further, they estimated that they would have to eliminate 25 million people in these re-education centers. And when I say eliminate, I mean kill 25 million people. I want you to imagine sitting in a room with 25 people, most of which have graduate degrees from Columbia and other well-known educational centers, and hear them figuring out the logistics for the elimination of 25 million people. And they were dead serious.
It is also important to know why Julian continues to be isolated from the world and abused. But before we go any further, we need you to close your eyes and remember back to how things were prior to 2015 in regards to Julian's situation. Go back and watch the featured interviews with George Stepan Olivas. Watch how the fake news corporate media lavished praise upon Assange, and how easily and freely awards were handed out to him, both at home and especially abroad. Now look at how he's portrayed by these same people today. What happened? Why the change? The very so-called fabricated crimes he's being hailed for right now were openly known way back then. The individual who gave military documents to WikiLeaks was freed from prison early. Yet Assange hasn't had the ability to absorb sunlight in more than a decade. Does that make any sense to you? It will. And by the way, if 12 plus years ago you did, for a brief period, believe that Julian and WikiLeaks were terrorists trying to bring down the United States, that's okay. This was something new. The climate was very different back then. And Julian was starting a venture and trying to desperately work out all the kinks and get it right from the beginning. They were doing something different. And often throughout history, folks cannot differentiate between white and black hats, especially in the early going. We know there are all kinds of factions who wish to collapse the United States of America, so there's no longer any impediment to a one-world totalitarian government. But this is not Assange. Julian has always been interested in cleaning out the malware, not pouring acid on a country's laptop. He's the perfect teacher, measured and careful, to teach the next generation ethical whistleblowing and journalism. We need him. You see, the accusations, or so-called charges against Julian Assange from the 2000s, are only the things the deep state apparatus wants to cling to. Why? Because Julian has done nothing wrong and has a journalist and, in fact, has shown more restraint and measure than most media figures in the mainstream have or ever will show. He and his former team at WikiLeaks went above and beyond to ensure they did no harm to any innocent person or group. To this day, there's zero casualties connected to anything WikiLeaks published. Imagine that. Did you know that Julian went out of his way to warn the State Department more than once that others were planning a potential leak, unredacted cables, which could potentially put people in harm's way? The corporate media didn't tell you that. They would a so-called enemy of America do that? Would a person who hated America do that? No, they wouldn't. He's the only enemy of corruption in the media. Also, did you know that a young Julian Assange in the 1990s successfully aided in the dismantling of child pornography networks using his technological skills? He worked with Victoria Police to do so. How many innocent children is he responsible for saving during his entire life? We may never know, but it's a lot. Now, Julian was treated well in the mainstream because although what came out in the early days was damaging and embarrassing to authority figures and countries, he hadn't tapped into the true underbelly or hornet's nest of darkness at that point yet. But that all changed after 2015. In 2015 and 16, Julian Assange, with the help from courageous whistleblowers, patriots, and concerned citizens, began lifting the veil and exposing decades and even centuries-old crimes, shining a bright light, a spotlight, on a dark underworld of unimaginable acts and behaviors, from wet works to child sex trafficking to international money laundering schemes. I mean, it's ridiculous. To weapon sales, to election rigging, to billions upon billions being legally funneled through various organizations funding terrorism and pay-to-play inside governments and foundations. This is when everything changed. Overnight, he went from being known as the innovative journalist interested in peace to a domestic terrorist. He went from being given awards to having large swaths of the world's internet being shut down and his own access to the internet being cut off simply to stop the release of such crimes and horrors. Ladies and gentlemen, the big secret is this, that everyone knows but no one will say it publicly. Julian touched the untouchable. Julian began to expose the unthinkable. WikiLeaks by itself, through information, helped elevate the entire independent media sphere, likened to a tide rising all boats. It couldn't have come at a more crucial time in America. You see, there wasn't supposed to be another election after 2016, and there wasn't supposed to be an America after 2024, at least as we know it now. As we stated from the beginning, there was no Russian involvement in 2016 election. Big hoax. It was all a lie, and a lie that has led to catastrophic decisions being made ever since. But as for choosing sides, as for Julian himself mentioned, the information given to WikiLeaks about Donald Trump wasn't anything that wasn't already known or important. You see, Donald Trump is the most vetted presidential candidate in probably world history, but definitely in American history. There's no other political figure that's had their life examined, re-examined, and then put under a microscope. Every single inch, every moment, in search of anything. The old famous dog, Joseph Stalin, the secret police head that he had working for him, famously said, "Show me the man and I'll show you the crime." Donald is the first political figure to sacrifice hundreds of millions of dollars to serve his country. That's why you're witnessing, right this moment, what they're doing to both Julian and Donald Trump. Period. So to finish up, we're also asking the folks over at InfoWars to dedicate their entire August 31st broadcast this year and following years to Julian also. You'll face many of the same trials and share many of the same objectives. Invite on his family, documentary filmmakers, and discuss all of the crimes and scandals WikiLeaks has uncovered over the years. Please consider. This entire presentation you're watching or listening to is copyright free. Upload it to your own channels. Help us get it on all platforms, mainstream and alternative. You can even put it out on DVD and play it at the department stores or gatherings. Upload it to your local public access channel. Put it on a 24-hour loop. Translate the video into different languages. Be creative. Just try to keep all those actionable details and links in the description with it. If you pull out small segments and clips, link back to the full presentation so people don't miss anything. Lastly, though we have differences in opinions and strategy with the Assange family and WikiLeaks, we send our love and our prayers to them in this time of need and applaud their relentless determination. The prime source you should look for updates is Stella Assange on Twitter at the moment. Follow her there and please invite her over to True Social, where millions of patriots await her with open arms. Lastly, you know, you can't say, when will someone do something, while ignoring those who have done something and are suffering alone for it. Remember that. Let's not wait for some blue beam, the alien innovation hoax, to unite everybody. Today, we unite for Julian and for press freedoms. Tomorrow, we shall return to the battlefield of ideas.
Here is a bulletin from CBS News. Here is a bulletin from CBS News.
Currently official, President Kennedy died at 1 p.m. Central Standard Time.
Good night and good luck. Could you afford to run for office? Our Campaign 92 coverage continues in a moment with the high costs of politics.
Are you ready? Where do you see the Syrian situation going? What should we do to stop the killings, to stop the bloodshed occurring in Syria?
David, who will you be voting for in the upcoming election?
Well, we don't have a candidate yet.
Well, I mean, amongst the candidates. What is WikiLeaks? We do something relatively simple. We want to enable information to go out to the public that is not just any information, but that it has the greatest chance of achieving political reform, positive political reform in the world. There's a lot of bits everywhere in the world. Some of those bits are special. Some of those bits can achieve something good. And the more bits there are in the world, the more the problem becomes, how do you find those bits which can change our civilization into a better state?
We would like to thank The Economist, who sponsored the award, and all those people, particularly our sources, who risked themselves to send in documents that the world needed to know.
And tonight, I want to thank you and the Walkley Foundation for showing these values as journalists and as Australians, and standing by WikiLeaks in our hour of need, not in 5 years' time, but today. Accounts. And I want to thank all of those who have continued to stand by us, our sources, our donors, our defenders, people without whom we could do nothing.
It's my great pleasure to present you with the Sydney Peace Medal for your conviction that truth matters and that justice depends on it, and for your courage and leadership and tenacity in journalism and publishing.
And I'm not for the death penalty, so if I'm not for the death penalty, I only want to do it illegally. Shoot the son of a.
He's a high tech terrorist. He's done an
Assange.
Hero, not a hero.
I don't think in terms of heroes. In generally speaking, I think he thinks he is a hero in his own mind, which makes me pretty suspicious. We should not have freelancers from other countries making decision about what gets declassified by our government. Mm-hmm. Our government should be better about it, but I don't want random Australians deciding for me. Nothing against Australia.
I got plenty against Australia.
We are doing everything that we can. We have a very serious, active, ongoing investigation.
So this is, to me, I just think an instrument like WikiLeaks is vital for a free and open society to exist. I just think that if in a free and open society, if we aren't able to find out the truth, mistakes like this get repeated over and over and over.
The first casualty of war is the truth. This disclosure is about the truth.
Secure phones to assist in staying anonymous? $5,000. Fighting legal cases across 5 countries? $1,000,000. Upkeep of servers in over 40 countries? $200,000. Donations lost due to banking blockade? $15,000,000. Added cost due to house arrest? $500,000. Watching the world change as a result of your work? Priceless. There are some people who don't like change. For everyone else, there's WikiLeaks.
The head of WikiLeaks, Julian Assange, recently described himself as a big admirer of yours. What did you think of that whole WikiLeaks operation, leaking names and the like? What was your reaction?
Well, I want as much transparency of government as possible. And I think WikiLeaks has worked very hard to make sure that nobody's been injured and there's no evidence that anybody has. But if our government is doing something wrong and they're hiding it from us, I think there is a moral obligation of those people who know it and can reveal that to us to let us know. They should tell us. But the government complains, oh no, they're going to release this information to the enemy. Well, I'm not the enemy. The people's not the enemy. The people ought to know what's going on. We ought to have our privacies protected and the secrecy of government challenged when it's totally unnecessary. And most of this is very unnecessary, all the spying that they do.
I want to tell you what I think is the way that wars come to be and that wars can be undone. In democracies, or the pseudo-democracies that we are evolving into, wars are a result of lies. That is war by media. Let us ask ourselves of the complicit media, which is the majority of the mainstream press, what is the average death count attributed to each journalist? Journalists are war criminals. And why one might think that should lead us to a state of despair, that the reality that is constructed around us is constructed by liars, is constructed by people who are close to those that they are meant to be policing. It should lead us also to an optimistic understanding, because if wars can be started by lies, truth can be started, peace can be started by truth. So that is our task and it is your task. Go and get the truth. Get into the ballpark and get the ball. And give it to us, and we'll spread it all over the world.
It's been reported that WikiLeaks has released more classified documents than the rest of the world's media combined. Can that possibly be true?
Yeah, can it possibly be true? It's a worry, isn't it, that the rest of the world's media is doing such a bad job that a little group of activists is able to release more of that type of information than the rest of the world has combined.
Well, President-elect Trump famously skeptical over the idea the Russians meddled in our presidential election. Well, some are not buying his denial. We've yet to see any actual proof that they did. In fact, just moments ago, our friend and colleague Sean Hannity interviewed Julian Assange, the founder of WikiLeaks. The interview airs tomorrow at 10 p.m. Eastern on this channel. But here's what he told Sean about the source of those Clinton emails. Watch.
Can you say to the American people unequivocally that you did not get this information about the DNC, John Podesta's emails? Can you tell the American people 1,000% you did not get it from Russia or anybody associated with Russia?
We can say, we have said repeatedly over the last 2 months that our source is not the Russian government and it is not state party.
To appear in the report is WikiLeaks founder Julian Assange. Assange has been holed up in the Ecuadorian embassy in London for the last 7 years until just last week when he was dragged out by British police. He tried to escape disguised as Gandalf the douche. He has aged a bit. When Assange first went into the embassy in 2012, he looked like this, and we've acquired some time-lapse footage of his aging process. He aged poorly.
Oh my.
WikiLeaks has had some unfortunate spin around it. What WikiLeaks has actually done is traditional journalism, very much in the vein of the White House papers and things like that. I believe that WikiLeaks has taken some of their larger files, like their larger repositories of just large amounts of documents, and distributed those using BitTorrent. I myself am not in favor of simply taking any random piece of classified information and broadcasting it for the whole world to see. There could be all kinds of bad things that would happen from that. But that's not what WikiLeaks is doing and has done. They've gotten their hands on classified information that indicated things that the general public would really like to know about, and in many cases talked about things that are probably illegal activity going on. And I think fundamental to any democracy is having a functioning journalistic system which will blow the whistle on bad things happening that aren't supposed to be happening. And I think that's a good thing.
The question is what advice he has on protecting sources, because so many people just simply use email and reveal their identity by doing that.
So on the one hand, I can say you're all screwed. You are all totally screwed, because everything is going onto the internet. I was with, I won't name him, but one of the most respected investigative journalists in the United States. And he checked his email in Gmail, was logged into Google, and then he goes and starts searching stuff. Well, he's still logged into Google, so you can saw his name in his Google searches. And Google keeps a history of everything being searched for. And he was searching for things on the story he was developing, and he's a national security reporter. I mean, you're just screwed. I mean, the amount of information that is being collected on everything that is done, and it's just impossible to work and communicate in a normal way unless you have technical specialists dedicated to do this for you, means that your information trails and your sources' information trails are just everywhere. But the chance is very, very low that a source will be busted. But there's a perceptual illusion, because every time a source is caught, their name is, even their face is in the paper. But every time the New York Times uses a source to inform a story, it's like the source never existed in the first place, because it's basically an anarchist act, right? Leaking is basically an anarchist act, and to be a mainstream publication, you can't be lionizing sources doing anarchist acts all the time. So you don't see the source mentioned at all in the story. All you see, documents see by the New York Times, all you see in an official speaking anonymously. But that's such a small reference that people don't see the source. So there's a perceptual bias that sources are getting busted all over, but there's not the perceptual understanding that sources are succeeding all over, and that the actual chance of being busted is extremely low, even in this incredibly aggressive environment.
Alan Turing, British mathematician who was widely considered to be the father of computer science, received a pardon under the royal prerogative of mercy by the Queen. Turing made vast contributions to the scientific and mathematical fields, but the Briton is perhaps best known as the codebreaker who cracked the Enigma code, the cipher used by Nazi Germany to secure its military communications. Turing's efforts gave the Allies an advantage and helped them to emerge victorious in the Second World War.
Brilliant mathematician, computer pioneer, but Alan Turing is best remembered for what he did during World War II at this secret British base at Bletchley Park in Buckinghamshire. He led a team which cracked the Enigma code, used by the Nazis to send messages. Historians believe the code breakers shortened the war by 2 years, saving countless lives. In his personal life, though, Alan Turing suffered immense anguish. In 1952, Dr. Turing was convicted of gross indecency and had to undergo chemical castration. He was no longer allowed to continue his security work for the government. 2 years later, aged 41, Alan Turing died of cyanide poisoning. A verdict of suicide was recorded. Now, following parliamentary pressure, he's been given a posthumous pardon.
The injustice done to him is corrected today by this pardon, and I think that is the end of that bit of the story.
The pardon was granted by the Queen under the royal prerogative of mercy at the request of the government, which described it as a fitting tribute to an exceptional man. Danny Shaw, BBC News.
The royal prerogative is a body of customary authority, privilege, and immunity, recognized in common law and, sometimes, in civil law jurisdictions possessing a monarchy, as belonging to the sovereign alone. It is the means by which some of the executive powers of government, possessed by and vested in a monarch with regard to the process of governance of the state, are carried out. Individual prerogatives can be abolished by Parliament, although in the United Kingdom special procedure applies. Though some Republican heads of state possess similar powers, they are not coterminous, have a number of fundamental differences, and may be either more or less extensive, confer reserve powers. In Britain, while prerogative powers were originally exercised by the monarch acting alone, without an observed requirement for parliamentary consent after Magna Carta, since the accession of the House of Hanover these powers have been generally exercised on the advice of the Prime Minister or the Cabinet, who in turn is accountable to Parliament, exclusively so, except in matters of the royal family, since at least the time of William IV. Typically in liberal democracies that are constitutional monarchies as well as nation-states, such as those of Denmark, Japan or Sweden, the royal prerogative serves as a prescribed ceremonial function of the state power.
Mexican president renews offer to grant asylum to Julian Assange in a letter to Biden. He sent a letter to the president saying, you know, we'll take him here, we'll give him asylum, let's just end this nonsense.
Yeah.
He explained that Assange, this is his letter to Biden, he said Assange did not cause anyone's death, did not violate any human rights. He exercised his freedom, and arresting him would mean a permanent affront to freedom of expression. We always like to pat ourselves on the back for all of our faith in democracy and the institutions, but here it's clearly that the president of Mexico understands a lot more about freedom than the majority of American politicians. And last month, López Obrador called Assange, quote, the best journalist of our time. What a great, great line.
That's right.
Great line. Does not deserve to be in jail.
And welcome back to Hannity. So in a recent interview with the New York Times, WikiLeaks founder Julian Assange had some harsh words for Hillary Clinton and the mainstream media. Let's take a look.
The American liberal press, in falling over themselves to defend Hillary Clinton, are erecting a demon that is going to put nooses around everyone's necks as soon as she wins the election, which he is almost certainly going to do.
Now, he was not mincing words there, but that's not all. In other interviews, Assange has said that he has, quote, significant documents that would be damaging to Hillary Clinton's campaign. Here to join us and explain more, the man himself, WikiLeaks founder Julian Assange. Julian, how are you, sir? Welcome to the program.
G'day, Sean. I'm well as can be expected for being detained for 6.5 years without charge.
You know what? I understand. You know, part of me in the beginning was conflicted about you. And I'll tell you why. I believe in privacy. I believe that people, especially when it comes to private emails, personal emails, et cetera, and I think people have a right to that privacy. On the other hand, you have done a lot of good in what you have exposed about how corrupt, dishonest, and phony our government is, and I applaud that. I think that's good that we know that. Do you understand people when they talk to you about the privacy issue?
I do, and we've exposed a lot of governments. WikiLeaks has, you know, we specialize in bringing the First Amendment to the world,
we were always very surprised that one of our biggest battles would be trying to bring it to the United States under an Obama administration.
Yeah, that's interesting you say. Why do you say that that's a surprise to you?
Well, because if you see the rhetoric coming out of the Democrats is that they're pro-civil liberties, and an important part of civil liberties is respect for the First Amendment and the rule of law. And that has broken down under the Obama administration. And Hillary Clinton was part of that process. She has, and the Obama administration has, attempted to prosecute more journalists and journalistic sources under the Espionage Act, that same Espionage Act that she was being investigated under, than all previous presidencies combined.
Yeah.
Not just more than any one of them, than more than all of them combined. So there's, under Obama, an epidemic has developed of abusing national security laws to crack down on what is legitimate use of the First Amendment. But there is, Hillary Clinton says, that she can't remember what a C in bracket stands for. Everyone in positions of government and in WikiLeaks knows it stands for classified confidential. And in fact, we have already released thousands of cables by Hillary Clinton. Here she is, Clinton. See, that's her signature, Clinton, with a C in bracket right there.
Wow.
Thousands of examples where she herself has used this C in brackets and signed it off, and more than 22,000 times that she has received cables from others with this C in brackets. So it's absolutely incredible for Clinton to lie. She is lying about not knowing what that is. But it's a bit disturbing that James Comey goes along with that game.
Wow. Julian Assange, fascinating. I do hope you get free one day. I wish you the best. Thank you for being with us.
Now, a blog called True Pundit says that they have a source that was at a State Department meeting. I'm going to read you what they said. Now, I don't know much about True Pundit. I'm not vouching for them as a blog. But in fact, I wouldn't even read this to you, except for the fact that the Clinton team has not denied it. And I'm going to show you their non-denials after I read you what apparently happened at the State Department when Hillary Clinton was there. They explained Clinton's State Department was getting pressure from President Obama and his White House inner circle, as well as heads of state internationally, to try and cut off Assange's delivery of the cables, and if that effort failed, then to forge a strategy to minimize the administration's public embarrassment over the contents of the cables. Hence, Clinton's early morning November meeting of state's top brass, who floated various proposals to stop, slow, or spend the WikiLeaks contamination. That is when a frustrated Clinton, sources said, at some point blurted out a controversial query. Can't we just drone this guy? Clinton openly inquired, offering a simple remedy to silence Assange and smother WikiLeaks via a planned military drone strike, according to State Department sources. The statement drew laughter from the room, which quickly died off when the secretary kept talking in a terse manner, sources said. Clinton said Assange, after all, was a relatively soft target. To what degree she was kidding, I hope to God she was kidding. But there's a couple of things here that makes these more likely to be true. Now, they have sources, but people make up sources. If it was a Trump campaign, I wouldn't pay it any mind at all. But this was well before that really got cooked up. And then they claim right there that she might have been kidding, and in fact that the room laughed. That's what the source says. Now, if they just wanted to paint all of them in a negative light, they would have said, no, nobody laughed. They meant it seriously, etc. And it gives them a little bit more credibility that they said that. Second piece of credibility is there is a leaked email with this headline. Anne-Marie Slaughter from State Writing to Huma Abedin and other, Cheryl Mills, all sorts of Hillary Clinton staffers. And the subject line is an SP memo on possible legal and non-legal strategies regarding WikiLeaks. Now, they did not get the email where they outlined illegal strategies against WikiLeaks. Boy, I'm sure they'd love to get that email. So, but it does make you wonder what those illegal strategies are. Were they really considering a drone strike? Was she joking? We don't know. Well, they asked Robbie Mook, her campaign manager. Let's go to his answer.
Can you respond to that? Do you think that was said in jest? Is it untrue? Well, how are you taking that?
I'm reticent to comment on anything that the WikiLeaks people have said. They've made a lot of accusations in the past. You know, Donald Trump and his allies are trying to do everything they can to change the debate here right now.
That was a non-denial if I've ever seen one. I'm hesitant to respond, and I'd like to divert your attention with a pivot. In other words, That might be true. Look, understand the context, and if you don't cover politics every day like I do, you might not get it. If that wasn't true, they'd come out and breathe fire. They'd be like, it's outrageous, it's scandalous, it's preposterous, there's no way that it's true. But he didn't say any of that. He said, well, I don't know, I didn't get a chance to look into it. Really, you didn't get a chance to look into whether Hillary Clinton even joked that they might drone strike and assassinate Julian Assange? If I was her campaign manager, I'd have looked into it. Then at one point, Hillary Clinton got asked about it. Listen to her non-denial.
Did you ever joke about droning Assange?
Well, I don't know anything about what he's talking about, and I don't recall any joke. It would have been a joke if it had been said, but I don't recall that.
Oh, she said it. Okay. I don't recall is a classic if you catch me later on tape. I was going to say I didn't remember. I guess I said it. She remembers. If it had happened, then it would have been a joke. Oh my God, she said it. If she didn't say it, you think she sits there and goes, oh, no way. She would be like, that's the most outrageous thing I've ever heard. Of course that's not true.
I can't for the life of me understand why he's still in prison. He has committed no crime. The skipping bail was a misdemeanor. But he was actually an asylee at the time, and there's a process to go through to remove asylum, which wasn't gone through. So Julian, now being 10 years in arbitrary detention, it's incomprehensible.
Today, you might have heard Julian Assange's father, John Shipton, has been touring the U.S. trying to drum up more attention to Julian Assange's case. As we know from just a couple of days ago, the final kind of witness, the final key witness against Assange that had claimed that Assange told him to hack into things like the Icelandic parliament's, parliamentarians' emails, etc., illegal hacking, had told this former employee of WikiLeaks to hack in illegally to various places. We now know that guy, Thordarson, has said he has admitted he lied, that he was lying for the FBI. He also is a well-known fraudster, sociopath, and I mean that by like doctors have diagnosed him as a sociopath. He embezzled $50,000 from WikiLeaks itself, which was when they fired him. So anyway, this is the end of Julian Assange's father's tour of America and with his brother as well. And I went down there today at the Department of Justice, outside the Department of Justice. Of course, they're not going to let us in. But Julian Assange's father spoke. That was the first time I'd met him. And his brother spoke. And we were right there at the Department of Justice. Like I said, of course, they're not going to let us in. Of course, they are the ones that could drop this. Of course, Biden could tell them to drop it. So Biden administration, DOJ, they could drop this right now and Assange could walk out the door. But they're not. They're appealing it so that they can keep him in prison. Even if they lose the appeal, they figure, well, we'll get another year of him in prison. That's their goal. And their goal beyond that is to extradite him to the United States to face 175 years in prison. So Assange's father was here. Then why? Why would they show up to hear what Julian Assange's father has to say? Why would they show up to hear that Julian Assange is a real person with a real family who is having his life destroyed, has had his life destroyed, and continues to? Why would they want to hear about that? It's not useful to them. It's not useful to the empire to pretend that Julian Assange is a real human being with a father and a brother, or kids, or a partner. And so, very few showed up. And they also don't want to write that article because their bosses don't want them to write that article. They don't want to hear about Assange. They would rather that be a quiet little thing that, you know, once a year they write one little article saying the DOJ is appealing the decision or whatever, and that's it. Also, there's the fact that every time, if the press were to write anything about Julian Assange, they basically, simply by the fact that they haven't covered him much, covered his situation much, if at all, simply that fact shows them to be ass clowns. And I use that as a technical definition. And if they do a report on Julian Assange, then they have to maybe mention or maybe remind people, even if they don't say it, why haven't you been covering it? Oh, you've been covering this because you are doing the job of the State Department. You are trying to make people forget that we have a journalist locked up right now simply by not covering it, simply by not making it a story. So they don't want to talk about it. They really don't. They want to avoid it at all costs. And every once in a while, they'll do one little article about his trial because they feel that they have to or something. But even in those, they always, you know, find ways to denigrate him or to make him sound like some kind of hardened criminal. You know, he was a hacker and he was trying to destroy the world. And we had no choice but to bring him down. And he worked with Russia. Even though none of that is true, not a word of it, but that doesn't matter. They'll print it anyway. So yes, Omar Assange is a hero. So anyway, there were events today, and I just wanted to let you guys know about them because, you know, I want you to know that these things continue to go on. The energy, thanks to you all, thanks to everyone who continues to talk about Assange, That is what's kept this story in the news to the extent it has been. And I mean, mainly the independent news, you know, obviously not the mainstream, but that is what's continued this story and continues the fight is that energy. So I just wanted you to know this goes on. Julian Assange's father and brother just finished a tour of the U.S. People are still talking about this. Of course, there's been a blackout of the latest update about his key witness, the key witness against Assange, admitting he lied, to the FBI, lied to the court. Of course, there's been a media blackout of that because there has to be. They can't admit that. That goes on. And another point, you know, it's often whenever you bring up Assange, you talk about Assange, it's easy to think, well, it's all been said. It's easy to feel that way. That Julian Assange is not an American citizen. I have made this first point, but not the second one. Julian Assange is not an American citizen. He has barely ever been to America. He's never operated his business, WikiLeaks, out of America. So why is it America that is allowed to go after him? He is not in America right now. He's not from America. He's not, he was never in America while they've been chasing him and trying to prosecute him and trying to lock him away forever.
Mr. Assange, hello, it's Cliff Johnson.
G'day, Cliff. Thank you for calling back.
Certainly.
Have you been briefed? Yeah, so the situation is that we have intelligence that the State Department database archive of 250,000 diplomatic cables, including the classified cables, is being spread around and is to the degree that we believe that within the next few days it will become public, and we're not sure what the timing could be, imminently or within the next few days to a week, and there may be some possibility to stop it.
And are these, and who would be releasing these cables? Is this WikiLeaks?
No, we would not be releasing them. We are, well, this is Daniel Dumtrite Berg, a previous employee that we suspended last August.
And so he apparently has access to the material that WikiLeaks also has?
Yes, that's correct.
And he has access to everything that you have, is that right?
That's correct.
Okay, and that includes classified as well as the unclassified cables?
That's correct.
I see. And in terms of what they took, does that mean that they now have the ability themselves, without your control or authorization to make this as available as they want? Is this now in
That's correct. And there's no attempted reduction program and no attempted harm minimization. In case there are any any individuals who haven't been warned, that they should be warned. So the material, there is an encrypted version of the materials on the internet somewhere that we do not control. One doesn't actually need to convey the material itself. One only needs to convey the location of the material and its encryption key. There is another possibility, which is the taking down of those files. That is a degree of research and effort that we do not have the capacity to do. It is there are not so many of them.
And you know all the locations of them, you think?
We know several, and it's probably not that hard to find the others.
Can you provide us with that location information?
I can encourage other people to do so. Our view is that it's more your problem than it is ours, but we have been calling the State Department and the embassy for over a day trying to explain the urgency, and they have not called back other than this call.
Well, I appreciate what you've told us, Mr. Assange.
Coming. I had hoped that today would be the day that Julian would come home. Today is not that day, but that day will come soon.
Yeah.
As long as Julian has to endure suffering and isolation as an unconvicted prisoner in Belmarsh prison, and as long as our children continue to be bereft of their father's love and affection, we cannot celebrate. We will celebrate the day he comes home. We are pleased that the court has recognized the seriousness and inhumanity of what he has endured and what he faces. But let's not forget, the indictment in the US has not been dropped. We are extremely concerned that the US government has decided to appeal this decision. It continues to want to punish Julian and make him disappear into the deepest, darkest hole of the US prison system for the rest of his life. That can never happen. We will never accept that journalism is a crime in this country or any other. Let's not forget that US agents plotted to kill Julian on British soil. His British solicitors were deliberately targeted by name, and their documents were stolen. Their illegal operations even targeted our six-month-old baby. It is sickening, and it is also a threat to everyone. On behalf of Julian and myself, I want to thank the millions of people around the world and the institutions that are already calling for this persecution to end. I ask you all to shout louder, lobby harder, until he is free. I call on everyone else to come together to defend Julian's rights. Not just Julian's rights, they're your rights too. Julian's freedom is coupled to all our freedoms, and our freedoms are lost in the blink of an eye. I call on insiders to come forward to expose the full extent of the misconduct that has led to Julian's imprisonment. And I call on the President of the United States to end this now. Mr. President, tear down these prison walls. Let our little boys have their father. Free Julian. Free the press. Free us all. Thank you.
Well, I suppose I just wanted my kids to be happy. That was the primary thing, anything I did as a mother, and I'm certainly not a perfect mother. I'll say that right from the start. No one is. We all have regrets about the way what we've done with our kids, although most parents have done their very best. Julian sometimes went to school, sometimes he didn't. He has been to a good school, and he's been to some that haven't been so good. He wasn't very keen on going to many schools because he was bright and they weren't fulfilling his needs. He was a very bright little boy, and gifted kids can be in need, same as it's almost a, it can be an educational disability for a gifted child to go to a school where their needs aren't being catered for. And I was concerned that he would lose his love of learning if he was bored. So there was quite a lot of homeschooling. I suppose all I really sought to do was for them to love learning, to love the investigation of learning, not to force feed so much, but to inspire a quest for learning. So I read good books, and I didn't give him theories, but rather, well, what do you think? How would you solve this problem? What would your answer that to be that to that question be? And then I might say, well, my answer is so and so, but then there's all these other people's. If it was a question of values, though, you know, is it good to hurt people or to lie or whatever, then I would be quite strong about that. But then I would give the reason why you don't do it, not just that you don't do it, but why you don't do it. And the kids were often running, reading very early. And once people have a love of learning, a love of reading, of course, then they can, the whole world is open to them. Julian is a deep thinking person. He writes extremely well. He's a beautiful writer, actually. He has a scientific mind. He enjoys journalism. He's an independent thinker. And he is quite a courageous person. And he enjoys adventure. So, and he likes working for himself. So put all that in together, then it doesn't surprise me that this has eventuated from it. As to how I feel about it, I never say that I'm proud of my children, and I never say that I'm ashamed of them. It's not up for me to think of him as some sort of product to be proud of or ashamed of. He's his own person. What I can say is I think he should be very proud of himself. If that makes sense. I think Australia should be proud of him as one of the Aussies that's gone on to achieve something, but I am in admiration of what he's achieved. But I don't like the word pride. It's just something that sticks with me. It's just a funny little idiosyncrasy that I have. But he knows that I believe that what he's done is worthwhile, and I'm supportive of it. Does that answer your question?
So is Julian Assange a hero for freedom and truth, or a terrorist who's exposing innocent, well-intended people and putting them in harm's way?
He is absolutely a hero. As Representative Connie Mack said on your show a couple of days ago, the people have a right to know.
Well, Well, what is his goal in revealing the things he's revealed? The first two batches of document dumps had to do with military secrets and military behavior. The last one, which seems to have gotten under the skin of more people, actually dealt with diplomatic behavior and showed diplomats speaking candidly, but then lying in public about what they were speaking candidly in private about. So what do you think Assange is trying to accomplish by revealing all this, Eric?
Well, he's trying to let people know what their governments are doing. And I think that what the reaction is proving that the people are scared, not of losing lives, but of losing their jobs, because they've been acting against the law. They've been pressuring other countries to violate their own laws, as they did in Spain. And they are committing crimes themselves. Hillary Clinton, for example, ordered diplomats to steal credit card information and passwords from other diplomats. This morning, she apologized to the UN chief for trying to steal his credit cards.
Now, is that the type of thing, as you understand it, that ordinarily occurs in the diplomatic corps, that American agents would steal private credit card information of their counterparts?
Well, apparently it is, but we haven't known about it because this is just one of the many secrets that have been kept by the U.S. Government officials and that we're now just finding out about. We need to be able to find out what our government is doing. It's up to us to rein in the government. They're not going to do it themselves.
Do you think that any of this will bring about a change in diplomacy or a change in military conflict? The fact that there could be the harsh light of truth and transparency shining on these people when they cut these deals and engage in criminal activity?
Absolutely. They will find it much harder to break the laws and to commit unethical behavior if they know that people are going to find out about it.
We have a chance to turn the pages over. We can write what we want to write. We gotta make things leak so we can get much bolder. Oh, we're all wiretapped now. We're all being fed lies. Not long till we get all the rats out. Once we turn on all the lies, you're the light of the first of our thing. Make it bright and make things clear. Oh, oh, oh. We're not gonna sit in darkness. We're not gonna live with fear. Oh, oh, oh.
His name, and he worked on the whistleblower train until some government secrets got out that threatened the wars of gain. In the fall of 2010, free speech was desperate and the news was half dead. By the winter it was going bad. The people were being had. The time they drove old Julian down, because his good work was growing. The time they drove WikiLeaks down, because the free speech was showing. Come sing, na 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 na. My American friend said to me, quick, go on Twitter and see. Now the banks have joined in the unfair conspiracy. PayPal, Visa, and MasterCard could make all of our money no good. They don't care about logic or fair. They risk the whole money system on Lieberman's dare. The time they drove old Julian down, because his good work was showing. The time they drove WikiLeaks down, because the free speech was growing. Come sing, na 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 na. Unlike the major media ban, WikiLeaks took a noble stand. Unlike the politicos, they kept justice at hand. Julian has transparency, he's proud and brave. But the Pentagon and Palin threaten him with the grave. I swear by the mud below my feet, we won't have free speech if we take this defeat. The time they drove old Julian down, because his good work was growing. The time they drove WikiLeaks down, because the free speech was showing. Come sing, na 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 na. The time they drove Julian down, because his good works was growing. The time they drove WikiLeaks down, because the free speech was showing. Come sing, na 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 na. Support Julian Assange, support WikiLeaks, support your right to free speech, support your chance to understand and know what your government is doing.
Sleep inside the eye of your mind. Don't you know you might find a better place to play? You said that you'll never be, but all the things that you've seen slowly fade away. I'm gonna start a revolution from my bed, cause you said the brains I had went to my head. Step outside the summertime sitting blue, stand up beside the fireplace, take that look from off your face. You ain't ever gonna burn my heart out. And so Sally can wait, she knows it's too late as we're walking on by. Her soul slides away, but don't look back in anger, I heard her say. Take me to the place where you go, where nobody knows if it's night or day. And please don't put your life in the hands of a rock and roll band. We'll throw it all away. Gonna start a revolution from my bed, said the brains I had went to my head. Step outside the summertime sitting, stand up beside the fireplace, take that look from off your face. You ain't ever gonna burn my heart out. So Sally can't wait. She knows it's too late as she's walking on by. So flies away, but don't look back in anger. I heard it say,
Julian, when you were young, you considered becoming a physicist instead of what you went on to eventually do. You had an innate desire to discover the source of the universe. The word universe comes from two words, uni, meaning one, and verse, spoken sentence. So universe, whatever it actually really is, translates to one spoken sentence. In Genesis 1:3, it says, "And God said, let there be light, and there was light." Julian, the answer has been right in front of you the entire time.
Jesus said, "For what shall it profit a man if he gain the whole world and lose his own soul?" What would it profit you to be freed if your soul would be lost? If you walked out today, you know there are wicked forces who will pursue you for the rest of your life. Put on the full armor of God. Jesus said, "I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though were dead, yet shall he live. And whoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Ask, and it shall be given to you. Seek, and you shall find. Knock, and it shall be opened unto you. For everyone that asketh receiveth, and he that seeketh findeth, and to him that knocketh it shall be opened." You have a shirt, and it says truth. At the peak of the mountain that is truth, there is one standing there and awaiting you with open arms, who told us, "I am the truth."
Here's to the overlooked, the overworked, the underappreciated. Here's to the fighters to preserve our freedom, our liberty, our rights, our faith. Here's to the workers, the farmers, the first responders, and those who serve so bravely in our military. Here's to Americans who proudly hold tight to our values: God, privacy, freedom of speech, life and liberty. Here's to the patriots who love this country and everything it stands for, who should never be canceled for believing in America and the blessings of liberty. Finally, there's a bank for you, Old Glory Bank, named after the flag that represents the fabric of this great country and the people of Old Glory Nation, the engine of America. Now you have a bank that values your values. Now you have a bank that stands with you, no matter where you stand. Old Glory Bank. We stand with you.
Member FDIC. Equal housing lender.
I hope you enjoyed that special video, folks. And get involved. Free speech is at stake. Whether it's Julian Assange's or yours, I'm sure that you don't want your free speech and your rights violated any more than he does. Thank you for joining us on this special live stream episode of Indivisible with John Stubbins. We'll see you next week on our regular show on Tuesday night, 10 p.m. Eastern. God bless you, God bless your families, and God bless America.